I once was lost, but now I'm found. Yahshua has chosen me and turned my world around. He's made me to know he's real and showed me just who I really am. His blood was shed for me to forgive me for all of my sin. And I'm so glad
I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free in Yahshua. I'm so glad I'm free, cause he's forgiven me for my iniquity. I'm just so glad I'm free today.
I was full of iniquity, pride and vanity. Through the preaching of his gospel, he's revealed both mysteries. Now I'm sure that Yahshua is the only righteous one. If we just have faith in him, by grace he'll make us a son. And I'm so glad
I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free in Yahshua. I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free, cause he's forgiven me for my iniquity. I'm just so glad I'm free today.
I'm free.
I'm free.
He opened up my eyes to see.
I'm free.
Yahshua was my sacrifice so that I could have life. He paid the price. That's why
I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free in Yahshua. I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free. Cause he's forgiven me for my iniquity. I'm just so glad I'm free today.
I'm free. Yahshua had mercy on me.
I'm free.
He opened up my eyes to see.
I'm free.
Yahshua was my sacrifice so that I can have life. He paid the price. That's why
I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free in Yahshua. I'm so glad I'm free. I'm so glad I'm free. He's forgiven me for my iniquity. I'm just so glad I'm free today.
Good morning. My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and a divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and there are gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabets that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of the Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we must ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Later on, he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among man whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be Exodus the third chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Salas.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for having us here today. The purpose learning about you, the salvation, and thank you for giving us all those things we can enjoy in life. And but the most important thing, the wisdom and knowledge you pour into our spirit. And keep feeding us. We are so happy knowing things not all the world know, but they have the opportunity to know. If they just listen and put attention in these classes. I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Good morning, class. Good morning. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Exodus, the third chapter, page 71. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Exodus, the third chapter. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptian oppressed them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto Elohim, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, Certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee, that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve Elohim upon this mountain. And Moses said unto Elohim, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them? And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asher Eya. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be, has sent me unto you. And Elohim said moreover unto Moses, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob, has sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together, and say unto them, Yahweh Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, appeared unto me, saying, I have surely remembered you and seen which is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt unto the land of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, unto a land flowing with milk and honey. And they shall hearken to thy voice, and thou shalt come, thou and the elders of Israel, unto the king of Egypt. And you shall say unto him, Yahweh Elohim of the Hebrews has met with us. And now pray, let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness, that we may sacrifice to Yahweh our Elohim. And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, but by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. And it shall come to pass that when you go, you shall not go empty. But every woman shall demand of her neighbor and of her that sojourneth in her house jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiments. And you shall put them upon your sons and upon your daughters, and you shall recover from the Egyptians. I have read Exodus, the 3rd chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. Before we get started today, I'd like to announce this is Sunday. We will have a lecture format today. We'll have a two-speaker format, so each speaker will have about 45 minutes for their discourse. Before I call on the first speaker, I would like to welcome a first-time visitor visiting with us, Anna Marie Sandoval. Guest of Dr. Fernando Valdez. Thank you for joining us. We hope that something is said today that encourages you to come back and study with us some more. And we welcome you in the bonds of peace. I will be the first speaker for today's class. And I appreciate having an opportunity to stand before the assembly of the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak of anything that has been brought to my understanding since coming down to one of these schools. Here in this school, we have different positions and titles that we have. They're not important as far as your salvation is concerned, but I'm the president. Right there is our dean, Dr. Marlon Love. It's important. We have a treasurer there, Dr. Eunice Reiser, and we have other officers that are not with us here. But this is a school. The school has to be run according to a structure and function, so therefore we have to have people like a president and superintendent and public relations and a dean in order to make sure that the body is getting what it's supposed to get, and we're not just willy-nilly, just flying by the seam of our pants, as people say. But this school, which is not a church, as it said in the moderation, and I recognize that you guys came in a little bit late, and in the moderation, at the beginning of the moderation, we tell you that this is a school and it's not a church, and we're not affiliated with any religious organization. Right. We are, the name of this school is the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Mm-hmm. So an institute is an organization like USC, if you would. Something that's divine is holy, is spiritual type of thing. Metaphysical. Meta means beyond the physical. That's what we are researching. The Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. And this school came into existence as the result of a divine vision and a divine revelation given to the founder of this school in the year 1931. And his name was Henry Clifford Kinley. He was a black man. He was in charge of all of the, he was a minister in the Church of God, and he was in charge of all of the healing that was at that church. And it came to be that about 15 years into his tenure as a minister in the Church of God, he was falsely accused of being with one of the women that was part of the church, and he was a married man. So he was cut off from the church. They wouldn't deal with him anymore. And he had given his all of his efforts into learning about God. And he had a question about God. He said to himself, he said, how could God justify destroying a creation if the people don't know of him? And that question he brought to the leaders of the church, and they didn't have an answer for him. And ultimately, since, you know, this thing was heavy on his mind, they came up with a way to get him out of the church. And he went into a deep depression type of state for some time, and he meditated on this thing. And there's literature where he writes, you know, his biography, and you can get more information about this because I'm paraphrasing these things. But after about 2 years of being out of the church, he was in meditation in his house in Springfield, Ohio, and he was just sitting on the porch, and he was taken up to the third heaven in his consciousness. And he had a divine vision. And what you see on all of these charts that are around this room is a result of that vision that he had. And he claimed that he had this divine vision from our Heavenly Father himself, whose name is Yahweh, and we'll get into that shortly, in proving that. Also in the moderation, we say, and you were here for that part, that we in this school, we show proof that everything in the universe, which is everything around you, everything that you can perceive and you can't perceive, is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern. Now, another thing about the founder of this school, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, he had a sixth grade education. And so he, as far as scholars go, he wasn't very scholastic for that matter. But at the same time, he was what you call a bibliomaniac. And that means that he knew the Bible front to back, cover to cover. You could start reading the scripture someplace, and he would tell you chapter and verse exactly where it was. And he was well known for that in his church. But getting back to what I was saying, he was sitting on his porch in Springfield, Ohio, and he he was knocked out of his chair, and he received a divine vision from Yahweh, our Elohim, himself. And he woke up from that vision, and his wife and children were there, and he had back problems from working, you know, heavy in machinery and factories and whatnot. So they thought he had a recurring back injury. So they carried him up to the upstairs to his bedroom, and he passed out again. And the time that he passed out again, he had a revelation of what he seen in the vision. And, you know, a vision, you see me standing here. All right. Now, revelation is the understanding of me standing here and talking to you about whatever it is. If you understand anything about what is said from this floor today, it is as a result of a vision and revelation. Please give me, before we move on, Romans chapter 1, start at verse 19, please. Now, this is what was called for many years the so-called swan song of the school, Romans 1, 19 and 20. And we read this quite frequently to express to the students that anything that you can know about this teaching, you don't get it from the person on the floor. You don't get it from anyone but our Heavenly Father himself. Please read.
Romans 1:19, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest.
Can you read it out of the King James Version, please? Now, it's also important to know where you're reading. In these books, the Bibles, there's so many different versions of the Bibles. You've got your King James Version, you've got your Yahweh Version, you've got New International Version, all of these different versions of the Bible. And what we do down here is, according to this pattern that we talk about, this tabernacle pattern, we can straighten out the misinterpolations. We can straighten out the mistranslations, because our Heavenly Father, he created everything according to a pattern. So if there's an error in something that man had wrote, we can straighten it out and reconcile it back to our Heavenly Father according to this pattern. And you stick around long enough and you will see that and understand what we're meaning. We're not tearing apart what anybody wrote in the book. We're correlating it to the divine purpose, pattern, and plan that our Heavenly Father laid out from the beginning of the creation. As you may have heard before, that the end of this creation was declared from the beginning. And this pattern shows proof of that. Now, please, start
King
again.
James Version.
Thank you.
Romans 1:19, because that which may be known of God is manifest.
Hold on. Because that which may be known of God. So there's something that you can know of God. Read.
Is manifest in them.
It's manifest in them. The definition of manifest is to be put in you. A good example that we like to use about manifest is when you go to the ports of Long Beach and you have a ship and there is a manifest. And everything that's inside of that ship is to be written on that manifest. And before that ship can be cleared for anything to come in and off, I don't even know what the name of the title of the guy who's in charge of it, but it's got to be cleared by somebody. That manifest has to be checked and cleared. And anything that you can know about your Heavenly Father is put in you, just like that those articles of the manifest of a ship are put into the ship. Okay, continue to read.
For God has showed it unto them.
Because God has showed it unto them. Read, please.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world.
So there are some things that are invisible about God. And they're from the creation of the world that these things are invisible. That you can't see them. Read, please.
Are clearly seen.
But you can see invisible things. How is that?
Being understood by the things that are made.
You can understand the invisible things from the creation of the world by the things that are made. Read.
Even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse.
Now, Godhead, what's that? We want to know what that is. Give us 1 John, give me King James Version still, 1 John 5 and 7. But before you read, I want to go over an explanation of this chart a little bit. Now, it says the invisible things of the creation of the world. Now, we have right here Yahweh being symbolized as a cloud. And we say in the moderation that he's not a cloud, but he just uses a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. This is because our Heavenly Father, Yahweh, or God, he will be what he wills to be. So he can take on the shape or take on the form of whatever it is he wills to take on the shape and form of. And in the beginning of the creation, before you read 1 John, give me John 1 and 1. In the beginning of the creation of this stellar universe that we live, move, and have our being within, Yahweh created the Word. This is the first thing that he created. This is the only thing that our Heavenly Father created. And he gave everything to this Word or Son to create after that. Please read when you have 1 John 1 and 1. And then,
oh, you want John 1 and 1?
No, yeah, I'm sorry. John 1 and 1. I'm sorry.
From King James?
From King James is fine.
Okay. In the beginning was the Word.
In the beginning was the Word. Now, in our book, you've got two beginnings. You've got Genesis 1 and 1. And you've got John 1 and 1. Maybe the next speaker will be able to get into that a little bit. I just want to lay a basic foundation, and we'll go from there. But in the beginning was the Word. This is the beginning of the creation here. Read.
And the Word was with God.
And the Word was with God.
And the Word was God.
And that self-same Word was God. This is showing forth a manifestation of the Godhead that we're going to get into in 1 John. But continue reading where you're at, please.
The same was in the beginning with God.
The same was in the beginning with God.
All things were made by him.
All things were made by this Word. Mm-hmm. Everything. And what you see right here is a pictorial illustration of the superincorporeal shape and form that God took on and that Moses seen when he was taken up into the top of Mount Sinai. And you see, you've got this white here showing the vision out of Yahweh our Elohim, or as it said, God in your King James Version Bible. And then you see this pattern of the tabernacle that we have down here that he was shown. And you see the day of creation, first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, and then the sixth day where Adam and Eve are in the garden in rest. First you have, see, you got the six in between right here because you've got Adam that was made both male and female. And he was put into a deep sleep and Eve was drawn out of him. The womb was removed and the rib was removed, flesh of his flesh, bone of his bone. And Adam and Eve were in the garden here in righteousness, peace, and joy, and harmony, up here resting. And then you've got the seventh where you've got him resting. He's not working anymore. And then a detailed configuration of this tabernacle right here that Moses was shown. Now, you can read about all of this that you see right here on this chart in Exodus. Start at the 24th chapter, and then read all the way down to about the 30th or 31st chapter. And everything that you see right here is explained in the book. So these pictorial illustrations that you see right here, they're not just something that the founder of the school, he just made up out of his own imagination. These are pictorial illustrations of the historical events that actually happened in the Bible. And let's go back to the Godhead, and I want to get back to talking about this vision in Revelation that the founder. I don't want to get too far off of base here, and I hope you're following me. Continue over in John where you're at, please.
Oh, okay. 3, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
Without him, this word that in the beginning was the word, it was with God and it was God. This word made everything, and without the word was nothing made that was made. Continue to read.
In him was life. And the life was the light of men.
In this word was life. In the life was the light, the illumination, the ability for me to get up here and stand around and do jumping jacks and eat food and talk to you right now. Anything that I can do, the light, it was given to me by this word. Read.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
And the light that lights all men shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. And that is the state and condition that we come into before we come to a true knowledge and understanding of our Heavenly Father as he really is and actually exists. The first aim of this school, and we'll argue to tell you that this the only aim of this school, is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. And we can show you this according to the pattern. Now, keep in mind that we show you this, but the only way that you can understand it is if God himself reveals it to you. He has to make it understood to you. You can have a person sit right here and a person sit right here, and both of them hear the exact same thing that's said. And this one understands, and this one does not, and never will. And that is the will of our Heavenly Father. He over here on this chart, you say, we told you earlier that he will be what he wills to be, and we use that cloud to symbolize that he has no particular shape or form. And so he will to be understanding, or he wills to be a delusion. And he knows his sons, and his sons know him. They will seek after him. They will want to know something of him. You will have a burning in your heart to know, to prove these things. And the founder, when he started this school, after receiving this vision and revelation, he told the people who came down to study, don't believe him just because he said it, but make him prove it until you're satisfied. Because if you can't prove this thing, if you don't know it beyond a shadow of a doubt, you must remain a skeptic. I don't care how many times somebody gets up here and says the exact same thing over and over and over again. If you don't know it, keep asking questions. Don't believe it. Keep investigating. Keep studying these things. Because if you diligently seek him, he will reveal himself to you. And that is a true statement. All right. Skip down to 14, please, because we started out, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and that Word created everything. There was nothing that was created without this Word, and that was the life and the light of all men. Now, 14th verse, please.
And the Word was made flesh.
Now, this Word that was with God and was God was made flesh. That's what you got right here with the Messiah. This spirit manifest in the likeness of sinful flesh, but had no sin, born through the virgin womb of Miriam, who the church calls Mary, of an immaculate conception. And this is what we're reading about right here. Read, please.
And the Word was made flesh and dwelled among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Full of grace and truth. Now, give me where you had in 1 John, please. Now, we got another chart right here that I'm going to use. And this chart is the first chart that the founder of the school had drawn up. And he drew it up on a bedsheet. This was in the 30s that he drew this thing up. And it still exists to this day. It's in Canada right now. Now, I don't know if you know about any bedsheets that have been around for about 100 years that are still intact and they'll hang up. But there is one. Now, and this chart is called the chart on the pattern or plan of salvation. Because our Heavenly Father, he done everything by a pattern. And he has a plan. And that plan is your salvation. And you are understanding the pattern of our Heavenly Father, you can understand something about the plan of our Heavenly Father. And if you understand and know these things, you will see the salvation of our Heavenly Father. Now, 1 John 5 and 7, King James Version.
Right. For there are three that bear record in heaven.
It says right here. You can zoom in on it. If you go on the full screen and then you zoom in right here, it says there are three that bear record in heaven.
The Read. Father.
The Father.
The Word.
The Word.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
And these three are one.
And these three are one. This represents the unity of the Spirit. Now, please continue to read.
And there are three that bear witness on earth.
Now, there are three that bear witness on earth.
The Spirit.
The Spirit.
And the water.
And the water.
And the blood.
And the blood.
And these three agree in one.
These three agree in one. Now, I want to explain that a little bit. We had in John 1 and 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. So God is pure spirit, as we say, no descriptive shape and form. He's not a cloud, but he wills to be what he wills to be. He took on shape and took on form as Yahweh Elohim. Okay? Now, the reason why the church is so confused, because they use Lord and God, and those are titles and they're not names. And every God has to have a name. Every Lord has to have a name. And where they took Lord and God away, they got confused in the scriptures. So when they write things down, you've got Lord where it ought not to be. You got God where it ought not to be. And they're both basically synonymous in their meaning. And right. and it leads you to not have the ability to have a profound understanding of the unity of the Spirit as it actually is. Before we go on with this, give me Exodus 20 and 7 real quick. And then I'll continue with what I'm saying. Because, see, God told us not to take his name away. And let me be specific with that, because I'm as what you would consider to be a Gentile. I wasn't born of the Hebrew lineage. But there are, as far as what you have in what we call the Old Testament, or the law and the testimony, you've got Jews and Gentiles. And God told those Jews on Mount Sinai not to take his name away. Right here. Please read.
King James Version.
Exodus 20 and 7.
20 and 7.
Yes.
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain.
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Now, the definition of vanity is not cursing or like being puffed up in something. The definition in the context of what's being written here is to make meaningless. You can look it up in a Merriam-Webster online. You got it in your phone in your pocket. You just go online, you look it up. You'll see that one of the definitions of vain is to make meaningless or useless. Now, you take a name away and turn it into a title, how much more useless it is? Could it be? I mean, I said that kind of wrong. How much more useless could it be? For example, if you're renting a property and you have a landlord, and it's time for the rent to get paid. Say it's the 4th and it's due on the 5th. And you write a check to landlord and you give it to the landlord. And they take it, they pull it out of the envelope at the bank and it says landlord on it. The bank teller is going to say, I can't do anything with this. Then the landlord is going to come back to you and say, since you're playing with me, you know my name, but since you're playing with me, here's a late fee. Write another check, write the name on it. Because you can't do anything with landlord. You have to specify which landlord it is. Unless, of course, the name of the landlord's corporation is Landlord Incorporated. Then he might be able to do something with it. But then landlord is made into a name. That way, it's incorporated. And it's taken on shape and form and has an identity.
Right.
So, that name that we use, Yahweh, is the original name that was given to Moses. And we had a scripture lesson read today, which is Exodus, the 3rd chapter. And that that 3rd chapter of Exodus is an account of where that name was given to man. Man did not have that name before Exodus, the 3rd chapter. And we want you to be mindful in your research to know that these chapters and verses that you have in your book, they are an invention as well. They didn't always exist, but they're used as a way to reference different points in the book. So we just want you to prove all things and hold fast that which is good. We want you to know everything. The founder of this school encouraged the students that come down here to learn everything about everything that you can learn about and understand everything about everything that you can understand. And that means not to just come down here and leave the church world alone and leave everybody out in the world alone and you just come down here and this is where you're going to get everything at. You will get the truth down here, but in order to understand the truth, you got to use the things of the world. That's what we just had read over there in Romans 1:19. Where the creation of the world explains the invisible things. So you come down here to research metaphysical things. These are spiritual things. But the world around you and outside of these doors will give you proof of the existence of the spiritual things. So if you're a member of a church somewhere, go back to the church. Ask your pastor questions about some of the things. You will probably find that they'll defer away from it. They won't want to give you answers. Sometimes they'll tell you things like the mystery of God. Yeah, it's a great mystery and you can't know anything about it. We beg to differ. You can know something about your Heavenly Father, and we show proof of this. But so three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. And there are three that bear witness to the unity of the Spirit in heaven. And that is the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. Now, here's a simple explanation of the Spirit, the water, and the blood. You have a physical body that you walked in here with. You needed that to get here and sit in your chair. Now, within that physical body, you've got blood, right? Also, in that physical body, that there it contains 70% water. If you get low on water, the blood's not going to act right. The water and the blood have to agree with each other. They have to have the proper amounts and levels. for your physical body to work right. Also, you have to breathe in oxygen. Mm-hmm. You inspire. The root word of inspire is spiros, or spirit. So, spirit, water, and blood. You have to have oxygen in your blood. You have to have water in your blood. You have to have blood in your body.
Right.
If you lose any of these,
yep,
we're going to have to cart you out here on a gurney. These agree in one, and they bear witness to the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. Now, we have this tabernacle that we talk about, and it's a most holy place. This is a pictorial illustration of that same tabernacle that we have over there and we have over there. It's just on this chart. And what it's used for right here is to show how this correlates with all of the rest of these different plates. These are all called plates that we have through here. You've got plates all through here. And what you have, what is that? Whom shall he teach knowledge? Isaiah 28 and 9. Is that what it is? Yeah. On this chart, you've got all these different plates. And they're all lined up. So you've got a blood line here on this. You see blood. You've got blood here. There was blood when the Messiah was put up on that cross. And there was water that came out of him as well, that here on this cross. And when he died, there was spirit. We'll go into that. You got a blood line, a water line, and a spirit line here. You've got blood in this tabernacle. I'll show you the steps of this tabernacle so that you can have an introduction on how we prove everything. Because my time is probably going to be running short. Just make sure you let me know when I'm out of time. This tabernacle has 7 steps into its operating, okay? The first step is, okay, we'll come back to that. The first step is here at the gate, which is an entrance, okay? That's how you enter into anything. Your second step is your brazen altar of sin offering. It says sin sacrifice right here. Those Jews, and the Jews only, and I made mention that I'm not a Jew. I'm a Gentile. But the Jews were given a law. That 10 commandments that was written there, we were just referencing Exodus 20 and 7, that was given to the Jews, and it was given to the Jews only. And the church will tell you that about the 10 commandments. But what they don't talk about is the other 603 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that they had to adhere to. And if they broke any one of those statutes, judgments, ordinances, or laws, they had to offer up a sacrifice. So they would come into the gate with their sacrifice, and this sacrifice would have to be slain on the altar right here. And there's 4 points of blood right here where that sacrifice would be slain at. Then the priest would have to wash and prepare that sacrifice on the brazen laver right here to be burnt on this altar, okay? Now, so you've got a blood principle right here, or a death principle right here. Then you've got a water principle right here with this brazen laver, or an inundation. That's where you get the baptism from. When you get dunked in the water, it's an inundation, and that represents a burial. Because when you sinned, you're likened unto your dead. So John was out there burying the people. And when they came back up, it was a type and shadow of a resurrection. But you've got, I don't want to move on to that. I want to show you. First step is the gate. The second step is the brazen altar of sin offering. And the third step is your brazen laver. Now your fourth step is the door to the holy place of the tabernacle. And at that door, there is a cup of holy anointing oil that is filled with olive oil. And the high priest and the low priest are the only ones that are allowed to go inside of the holy place of this tabernacle. Now, the low priests are allowed into the holy place. The high priest alone is allowed into the most holy place, and that is only on the Day of Atonement. Okay? And there's a specific structure and function to all of this. It has to be right. So, in order to get into this holy place, you have to have an anointing. And they pour this oil all over your head, all the way down your body, and you're totally covered in it. Okay? And that is a representation of a quickening. That is a representation of spirit. Okay? And we'll show, I'll use this over here to show a correlation of that in a moment in your physical body. Now, once you've been anointing and you're allowed, once you've been anointed and you are allowed into this holy place, that is the fifth step inside of the holy place. The entire holy place is the fifth step. Within the holy place, you have the seven branch golden lampstand. Now, it says up here on the chart that candlestick, but we want you to know that that's an error, and it should be lampstand, because back when they were walking around here in the wilderness of Sinai, they didn't have wax for candles. What the way that this operated, this was beaten out of one piece of gold, and it was hollow in the middle, and when the priest would fill this up to light it up, they would pour oil in the fourth middle branch right down here, and that oil would spread out to each one of these branches, and they would light each one of those using the oil. But it was no candles, so we don't want you to be confused and think that this was a candlestick as you see on Hanukkah or whatnot. That candle is an invention thing. And we want you to, the reason why I drew that out is because you need to have a profound knowledge and understanding of the structure and function, and not according to an imagination. So you've got your seven branch lampstand that's in here in the holy place. You've got your table of shewbread that was in the holy place as well. And it had 12 loaves of bread for the high priest and the low priest to eat on. And there were six on each side. And there's a special representation. I don't want to go into that right now because for the sake of time. The next main furnishing that was in the holy place is your altar of incense. And only the high priest knew the composition of the four ingredients that was put on this altar of incense. It was made up of galbanum, stactes, frankincense, and myrrh. But only the high priest knew the composition and how much that it needed. And there's this was used to mask the stench that was coming off of this brazen altar of sin offering, and from that stench coming up into the most holy place, where the Lord God, properly known as Yahweh, sat on the throne right here. So you've got lampstand. See, because it says candle, I get messed up sometimes. The lampstand, the table of shewbread, and the altar of incense here in the holy place. Now, the sixth step to this tabernacle is the second compartmental veil. You've got your first compartmental veil that's right here at the door. And this is an overhead view of the tabernacle. Can you hand me the one in Spanish, the tabernacle chart in Spanish, so that we can...
It's not here.
Yo, you don't have it here?
No.
Okay. Never mind. The reason why we have a chart behind the TV right there, I wanted to show you this tabernacle in like a three-dimensional... can you see it now? Can you see it now? So, this is what that tabernacle was made like in the wilderness of Sinai. And you've got the court round about. You've got all the boards and pillars that are around. And then you've got, outside of this, you've got the 12 tribes that camped around this tabernacle. Court round about, you've got your brazen altar, sin offering, you've got your gate right there, you've got your brazen laver right there, and then your door. And I wanted to show you that so that you had a good view of what that first compartmental veil looks like. And then right inside the other side of that, you got your golden lampstand, You've got your table of shewbread. You see the six loaves, right, or the 12 loaves right there, and six on each side. And then you've got your altar of incense right there. And then you see a blue, purple, and scarlet veil that's covering, and you see an angel. And there's another part of a wing right there to show that there was more than one angels, but there were angels embroidered on this second compartmental veil. And this veil was never open. That's enough of this. But so you got, before I leave this, because I'm not going to come back to it, so he can move that. You've got your court roundabout, your holy place, and then there's a veil that separates the holy place from the most holy place in the tabernacle pattern. Okay? And then it's covered up with ram skin, goat skin, and sheep skin, dyed red. And you see that right there. And you got the 12 tribes around it, like I said, and each tribe has a banner, and maybe the next speaker will go into that. But we want you to know something about this tabernacle, because this tabernacle was given to Moses to construct. And they were given all of those laws, the 613 that I mentioned. If they broke a law, they had to offer up a sacrifice. And give me Deuteronomy 6 and 24, please. Okay, 5 minutes.
Deuteronomy 6:24. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear Yahweh our Elohim for our good always.
To fear Yahweh. And that's the beginning of knowledge, is to fear Yahweh is the beginning of knowledge. Now, continue to read, please. That's in the book, too. Maybe the next speaker can get that. But read.
That he might preserve us alive as it is at this day.
That he might preserve us alive. Read, because we want to be preserved. We want life eternal. And give me John 17:3 after this. But go ahead and read.
And it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments.
All the commandments, not part of them. If it'll be their righteousness if they observe to do all of the commandments that was given. The whole lot of them. Mm-hmm. But they couldn't do it. So it necessitated that a Savior, which is named rightly Yahshua the Messiah, not Jesus. It couldn't be Jesus, because to this day, there is no J. And I'm not mad. I just get excited about this thing because it's important. But to this day, there is no J. There's nothing that sounds like J in the Hebrew language. And it's without controversy that that the Messiah was of the Hebrew lineage. But continue to read right where you're at, please. Because we want to be preserved and we want to know something about. Read, please.
All these commandments before Yahweh, mm-hmm. our Elohim, mm-hmm. as he has commanded us.
All right, that's it, right? Mm-hmm. All right, now give me John 17:3, please. I'm running out of time quickly. But while you get that, we have the fifth step. The sixth step is the second compartmental veil, and this is never open. There's never any light in the most holy place of this tabernacle. And the only one, like I said earlier, is the high priest that can go up there on the Day of Atonement. And in this most holy place, you've got the Ark of the Covenant, which is a 3-in-1 configuration. You've got the two angels overshadowing the mercy seat and the law that's placed in the mercy seat. Now, you've got 1, 2, 3. That's a 3-in-1 configuration. You've got 1, 2, 3 in this holy place. You've got 1, 2, 3 in the court roundabout. Now, you've got 9 principal furnishings that are making up the structure and function of this tabernacle. And all three of these 1, 2, 3 compartments make up the one tabernacle. And right over here, you've got spirit shown in description in attributal state. Intelligence. You can't see intelligence, but you can appreciate intelligence. You know when somebody knows what they're talking about. Wisdom. You know when somebody has wisdom, when they've gone through something before. Knowledge, when you have a diagram of something, if you have a car and you break it down and you explode it, you have knowledge of all of the parts and the components that make up that vehicle or vessel, if you will. So you've got intelligence, wisdom, knowledge. You've got love, beauty, and justice. You've got foundation, power, and strength. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, all making up that one tabernacle. All of these are wrapped up in the kingdom of our Heavenly Father, Yahweh. And our 10th objective of this school is to inherit eternal life now in that kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. John 17:3, please.
John 17:3. And this is life eternal.
Now, this is in your book. So if you never heard this before, take it with you. Write it down. We encourage you to take notes about the things. If you don't agree with something, take mental notes, write them down, whatever. We want you to investigate these things. We're carefully laying these things out for you to investigate so that you can prove it and know it beyond a shadow of doubt. And right here in the book of John, 17th chapter, 3rd verse, it's explained what life eternal is. That's what we go to church, and that's what we want to know something about God for, is to get life eternal. And this is it. Read.
And this is life eternal, mm-hmm. that they might know that.
That you might know. Read.
Thou only art the true El.
Thou only art the true El.
And Yahshua the Messiah.
And Yahshua the Messiah.
Whom thou hast sent.
That's life eternal for you to know. Give me Matthew 11:27 real quick, because I know I'm out of time. Because I want to tie this up. There's got to be a knowledge here. We read in Romans 1:19-20 that which may be known, that's knowledge, is manifest. We got life eternal, that you know your only Elohim and Yahshua the Messiah who he has sent. Now read over in Matthew 11:27, please.
And turning to his disciples, he mm-hmm. said,
this is Yahshua talking to his disciples. Read.
All things are delivered unto me of my Father.
Everything that Yahshua had when he's talking to, everything that he got, the knowledge and understanding that he got, is delivered of it to him of his Father. Read.
And no man knoweth the Son but the Father.
No man knoweth the Son but the Father. Read.
Neither knoweth any man the Father.
Neither knoweth any man, any one of us, we don't know the Father except what?
Save the Son.
Save the Son. Read.
And he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him.
He to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Okay. Now, he goes on to talk about taking on his yoke and learning of him, right?
Right.
Read it real quick.
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden.
So you're doing all of these works of the law, which is the kingdom unto the Jews and the Jews only. You heavy labored and laden. Now, what is it you got to do? You got to come unto who? Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
And I will give you rest.
He'll give you rest. And I'll tell you, in this tabernacle, this seventh step right here, this denotes the rest or the Sabbath. That's why when Moses was taken up here on the top of Mount Sinai, and he wrote in Genesis 1:1, and he got down to the sixth day, and he said, on the seventh day, Yahweh rested from all he was doing, because the seventh day denotes perfection. He had put it all, and he declared it all from the beginning. He declared the end from the beginning. So you got to know that the rest is in the seventh day. So he said, he'll give you rest. Right. He said, no man can know anything of the Father unless you go to the Son. You understand what I'm saying? So the Son knows the Father, and the Son will show you the Father and give you the rest, because you are what you're looking for. You are a microcosm of the great macrocosm. That's why you got, as I said over here, you got the holy cup of anointing oil right here at the fourth door, which is a quickening. Right here above your kidneys, you got your adrenal glands. And if you get in an emergency situation, that quickens you. It makes you fast. You can lift cars. You can save your baby. You can save yourself. You can save somebody in danger. Now, I'm out of time. I hope and trust that something was got out of what was said from today. And I really hope that you come back and study with us some more. All praises be to our Heavenly Father, Yahweh, through his only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For our next speaker, I would like to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for coming and joining us today and to learn something about God, about the Bible. Have you ever heard of the name Yahweh before, by chance? No? Okay. I enjoy the remarks and the foundation that the previous speaker laid. it was a plethora of things that we can jump off into and to understand and to hopefully know if Yahweh gives us an opportunity to see that. And we're talking about seeing. The previous speaker talked about you can see me, but you can't see what I'm really about unless I say something to you or present myself to you so that you can know something. You know I'm a man, but then you don't know my name. And this is what we're trying to impart and teach people and show people where they're in error at. Because if you're in error, there's no salvation because you don't know. And what has happened is that the world, by way of Satan or the devil, has deceived the people, meaning has blinded them or put a veil across their consciousness of understanding something. And what we're talking and what we're using are allegories, analogies, similes, in order to draw a person's consciousness out from what they think they know, from what they have heard or what they've learned. For instance, they have this letter J put onto this name of Jesus. And the whole world, you've heard of Jesus before, right? And so the whole world God has this name. And they believe that that is the Son of God, right? Or is it of the Lord? Which one would it be? A son of. Now, grab me John 5:40. He come in his father's name.
5:39.
Yeah, 5:39. Yeah, we'll start with 5:39 because as the previous speaker went about talking about the Bible, sometimes people have heard of the Bible being the Word. This is the Word of God, right? Give me a Bible. Tell me. I'm a real, give me a Bible. See, they'll have their Bible. Give me the black one. Everybody seen the black Bible. They say, this is the Word of God. Seen this demonstrated before, right? They say, hey, the Word of God is in here. And they think that this is the Word. But see, we have the Word up here. He talked about that Word being incorporeal. Now, this wasn't written before this came. But this was in the Word. John 1:1 said the Word was with Yahweh.
That's right.
And the Word was Yahweh. This book wasn't around. This book is compiled writings of various people that were inspired to write by the will of the Word. The Word inspired the people, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Moses, to write what they wrote. They themselves didn't take it upon themselves and experience something and say, oh, let me write about X, Y, and Z. No, the Holy Spirit, just like you have a thought sometime, you had a thought sometime to, I don't know, you're an artist. Rappers are great. I love rappers because they come off the top of their head, they're just spitting. And they're not writing nothing down, but they're just it's just coming to them automatically. Da Vinci drew those drawings without a lot of training, right? And he's just able to draw, inspired by the Holy Spirit. This is what we're getting at, and this is what we're talking about, that this Word is Spirit. And it's this Spirit that moved the people to do and to write what's in the book. Therefore, we have to understand what the Spirit is talking about. Now, in that book, you've heard of the Old Testament, you've heard of the New Testament, right? You got an Old, and then you got a New Testament, correct? That's how you would perceive, because in that fly leaf in the book, you got a New Testament. Right. And a lot of times, people try to live by the New Testament. They don't want to deal with the Old, because the Old is the old, mad, mean God. That God that killed babies and killed people. Yeah. And it's just a wicked old God that the new God, the beloved Jesus, Lord Jesus Christ, he never does such thing. He is just a good old boy. Yeah. And he just means everybody love and happiness and just love me. Huh? That's how they see. And you take them to the Old Testament, they say, oh, no. I don't want to, you know, don't talk about that. Why not? Because this is what he said. Read it. John 5:39.
Holy Name Bible.
He's telling his boys, his scribes and Pharisees around, and he's about to tell them this. Read.
Ye search the scriptures.
They search the scriptures. Another thing people say. They say this is the word, and they say that all scriptures are in here. They're not all scriptures. That's what I'm going to teach you today. They're not all scriptures. Because that's Yahshua the Messiah, or their beloved Jesus, telling the scribes that ye search the scriptures. They didn't have the Bible back then. Because Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that's in the New Testament wasn't written yet. So you have the Jesus saying, ye search the scriptures. They weren't searching the Bible. They were searching the Old Testament portion of the book. That's what they had. So you see it, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which you've heard about. And Jesus is saying, or Yahshua is saying to them, ye search the scriptures. And what?
For in them ye think ye have eternal life.
So that eternal life is to know that we had read in John 17:3, right? They thinking they're going to have life. And you have a whole lot of people reading the Bible. And they throw a lot of Bible verses at you. And they say, you should know this. You should know God. You should know Jesus. And they don't know nothing about scriptures. Because what scriptures he's talking about is about him. And he just got done reading Matthew 11 chapter, the 28th verse, talking about take his yoke upon him and learn of him. Therefore, if the scriptures are about him, you've got to use the Old Testament. And the Old Testament is comprised of the law. Okay? The Old Testament has two parts. You have the law and you have the testimony. Isaiah 8:20. That's the testimony. These two things. One, two. Read it.
To the law and to the testimony.
And to the testimony.
If they speak not according to this word.
If they, anybody, any Bible thumper, any Bible maniac, any Bible lover, if they not speaking according to the law and according to the testimony, what is it?
It is because there is no light in them.
There's no light. Remember that this was the light that lighteth every man in the world. Therefore, you have to have an understanding. And if they're not speaking according to this law and this testimony, there's no light in them. Read it.
Mm-hmm. Keep going?
Yeah, keep going.
And they shall pass through it, hard pressed and hungry.
They, the people that don't know and understand the real name of their Savior, which is Yahshua the Messiah. You see? They're going to pass through because they're not going to come to the law and the testimony. They're going to give you a lot of lovey-dovey stuff about a erroneous name of Jesus Christ, and they don't know nothing about this gentleman. And so when we come with you with Yahshua the Messiah, we're understanding that Yah means Yahweh, you see, and Shua means Savior or salvation. So therefore you have Yahweh is salvation. Now follow on, go back to 39 and continue to read, because we're going to talk about this Jesus and make it clear that Lord's the title and God's the title. They're not names, you follow? And we're going to see Jesus be talking to the scribes about the Old Testament, that they're about him. Read back to 39.
Ye search the scriptures, uh-huh, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Right.
And they are they which testify of me.
They, plural, these two things testify of Jesus, they'll say, right? Keep reading.
But ye will not come to me, uh-huh, that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men, mm-hmm, but I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
Mm-hmm. Read.
I am come in my Father's name.
Right there. How does Jesus come in the name of the Lord or in the name of the God?
Right.
That becomes the problem with that question. And when the new people read that, they can't answer that question because Jesus is erroneous. Erroneous means irrelevant. Jesus could not have come in Lord or God's name. Read it correctly. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, that's fine. Grab me. You're in John, 1 John right now, right? No, we're in John 39.
John 5:39.
So Jesus is saying, if you just read it as King James Version, that Jesus is supposed to come in his Father's name, and it can't be, because Lord's not a name, God's not a name, and this is erroneous. Now, we introduce to you today that Yahshua, which is Yahweh, is salvation. He, this name, came in his Father's name,
right,
of Yahweh.
Right.
You follow? See, the Yah portion of the name here is like the Yah portion of the name here. So now you got something to make that statement true. The previous speaker talked about, hey, we don't have a problem with the writings of the Bible, any Bible. It just has to be understood how to apply the proper terms and conditions to it in order for it to make sense. So they can paraphrase the Bible all they want to make it easy reading for people, but you're still going to have to come back with the fact that Yahshua was the name some 3,500 years ago that died on Calvary, that the whole world going to profit me, make money off you on Passover, thinking that it's something special, as though they're witnessing to this guy's death. See, we acknowledge that Yahshua died on the cross, but he's returned back into our hearts and minds of those who believe in Yahshua. But you have a dead world believing in a Jesus Christ on the day of Passover, because that's what Passover means. It depicts what happened or what was instituted down here in Egypt. It was Yahweh's first Passover. Grab me 12 and get down to the end. I just wanted what this Passover was, that the whole world is going to be dilly-dallying in and prophesying on and leading the people's consciousness astray, not understanding what the Passover is really meaning.
Exodus 12 and 1? Exodus?
You mean it's Exodus 12. I want to skip all the way down to this is Yahweh's Passover.
11.
Uh-huh. And I'll have to tie it back up why we're going to bring it here. Read.
Exodus 12 and 11.
Uh-huh.
And thus shall ye eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover.
See, that's the institution. That's the first Passover that Yahweh is setting up with mankind. You follow? That's just to catch on to that Passover, that's because we're going to be dealing with Passover coming up in this month. So I want you to be wary of that. That's the institution of Passover, Yahweh's Passover. Now, Yahshua was that lamb or that sacrificial lamb that died on the cross, and he fulfilled this Passover down here. You see, and what we need to understand is I need to make clear what we're talking about here. So let me go back again. He's coming in his Father's name. You see, Yahweh is both masculine and feminine. Yahweh doesn't need a goddess in order to create anything. Yahweh is the creator of both everything, right?
Right.
Yeah, we had Ayah, Asher, Ayah. I will be what I will to be. When we read there in the Exodus, the 12th chapter, Ayah, Asher, Ayah, this is Yahweh because he's both male and female. When we breathe, we inhale, and when we exhale, Psalms 150:6 says, everything, let everything that has breath praise the name Yahweh, because everybody breathes the name Yahweh.
Right.
You've seen a dog run, or you've exercised, and you get the, well, you're breathing in that name of Yahweh, unbeknownst to you. And see, this YHWH, known as the Tetragrammaton, 18-letter word, this YHWH, right? That's what the Hebrews had. This was the name that they took out and replaced with the Lord. See, you don't put the in front of a proper name. I don't say the Anna Marie. It's a proper name. I say the Sandovals, because it's just your last name. But your name doesn't use the in front of it. But you say the Lord, and you say the God. Mm-hmm. You follow? You don't say the Jesus. They just say Jesus. But see, Jesus coming, or Yahshua, comes in his Father's name. And you don't say the Yahweh. It's Yahweh is the name of your Father or your Heavenly Father. See, Elohim is a title. It's not a name. Elohim is a pluralistic title. That's why they put God here. And as the previous speaker says, they get twisted up as to how does that actually work. I'm going to need John 1:18 and Exodus 24, right? Talking about this God real quick. And then Yahshua is a name. You don't say the Yahshua. It is Yahshua, or Yahweh is salvation. And what we have to understand is that Yahshua is the Holy Spirit. The previous speaker talked about the unity of the Spirit, right? And we had it read. These three bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. See, we're not talking about names anymore. We're talking about an understanding of the unity. We see Father as Yahweh, and we see the Word is Elohim, and we see the Holy Spirit is Yahshua. Why? The Father is pure spirit. He transformed into Elohim, and this Word or Son manifested or transformed into a physical body and walked the earth plane for some 33 and a half years. This is the unity or the oneness of the Godhead. No Trinity, no separate beings, no body agreeing and talking in heaven, up in the sky, wondering what's going on. It's just one spirit operating in the physical world whereby we can learn and know all about him. Now, let's read John 1:18 in the King James Version.
No man hath seen God at any time.
Now, you, me, anybody, no man has seen God at any time. Read.
The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father.
Only the Son, Yahshua, has seen the Father. We had that read earlier. But no man has seen God, right? Now, grab me Exodus 24:9-9.
I
think it starts there, yeah.
Yeah. Exodus 24:9.
We're talking about God. No man has seen God. You, me, or anybody, past or present, never seen God.
24:10.
Okay.
And they saw the God of Israel.
And they saw. How many was they? Go up.
Then went up Moses, on 9th verse.
Yeah.
Then went up Moses and Aaron.
Aaron.
Nadab.
Moses, Nadab.
And Abihu.
And Abihu.
And 70 of the elders of Israel.
Now 70 other people. You got 74 people went up, and they what?
And they saw the God of Israel.
Now they didn't saw God. At one place said, no man has seen God.
Right.
And now you're saying that 74 people have seen God.
Right.
And see, this is what baffles the world, and they get pissed because the Bible don't make no sense. It's contradicting itself. It's not right. Well, it's not right in one hand because you used the wrong title and the wrong name for your creator. Therefore, it's not going to make sense.
Right.
But if you put it back originally like it's been taught, or that it was originally written in Hebrew, then it will make sense. This is as simple as we're trying to make it, and we're not trying to create no new religion, and this is not a religious school. This is a school of study, a school of research, a school of explaining that which is incorrect. You follow? And when we see that Jesus didn't come in nobody's father's name because he ain't got a father, because it was made up. There's no J here in Latin, Hebrew, or Greek until this day. They don't have this character. So how is it and why is it that the whole world, even the Pope, we're going to talk about a Jesus? They're delusional. That's the delusion. That's the veil that keeps people from understanding who their creator is, or that Holy Spirit that operates us and lives and moves within us. They don't see that. And it's just simple things that we're trying to convey. And they say that we're taking away their Jesus. And they don't understand or accept the name of Yahshua, the Messiah, which was the name given. What I have holding. Now we want to read it correctly.
Yeah, you want John 1:18.
Yep.
In the Holy Name Bible.
Yes.
All right. Just give me a second. All right. So, John 1:18, Holy Name Bible.
Yeah.
No man hath seen the Father at any time.
No man has seen the Father at any time.
Right.
That's what no man has seen. And we said, Yahweh is inscrutable and incomprehensible. You're not going to figure Yahweh out in his pure spirit state. You look at a cloud, you can see different shapes and concepts and colors and shades. That cloud is indescribable. You can't figure that out. You can't see spirit. You have sight, touch, sound, taste, and smell are your five senses. That's all you got to learn with or learn by. But you can't learn nothing about spirit with them five senses. That's why it takes a consciousness for you to see what we're expressing. If you see that, how should I say? If you see that we just read that God, that no man has seen God, is incorrect because we read somewhere else that 74 people saw God. Mm-hmm. Now we're saying that no man has seen the Father, which is correctly rendered, and we know that the Father has the name of Yahweh.
Right.
And so we're, huh?
Yes, I said just
so we're fine. That's a correct statement that John wrote. Now read it out of the Exodus.
Exodus 24 and 10, Holy Name Bible.
Yeah.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Now they saw the Elohim of Israel. That's what they saw in their consciousness, you see. Mm-hmm. That's what they were able to perceive and see, but they did not understand. They just saw it. Just like the previous speaker said, our founder had a divine vision. He saw the division, but he didn't understand it until he had a revelation. Just like I'm giving you a revelation about Jesus now. No J, no Jesus. And we're getting to understand about Yahshua being the true name of the Son of Yahweh. Elohim's the title. So and they're one. They're not separate. So there's not an Elohim guy and there's not a Yahweh guy.
That's
you
right.
See, it's all Yahweh in manifestations. And we're trying to, within our conscience, understand about Yahshua. Now, we had Exodus, the third chapter read. I want this to be known too. When we read in Exodus, Moses came to a burning bush. That it was on fire and it was not consumed. Right. Why am I bringing this point out? Because this is where you start your Bible. This is where the Bible starts. It doesn't start in Genesis 1 and 1 in the beginning. It's like the previous speaker said. It's got two kind of beginnings, right? You got the Genesis 1 and 1, and you got John 1 and 1. Which beginning are you going to begin with? He explained to you that beginning, that John, that Moses saw here in a vision is a beginning, because this is the beginning. John talked about in the beginning, the Word was with Yahweh, and Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. That was the beginning. But now we're talking about Exodus. It's important to start in Exodus, because in Exodus, this is where he received the name. Grab me Exodus 6 and 3 talks about Abraham and Isaac and Adam, they never knew the name of Yahweh. And at this time when Moses is 80 years old, he receives the name of Yahweh for the very first time. And it's this name of Yahweh that's going to be for all generations. And so you have to have an Exodus before you can have a Genesis.
Right.
You follow? If I was to buy this pen in the store, it comes wrapped up. You go to barcode, I have to pay for it. And then what I have to do, I just can't start writing with the pen inside the wrapper. I have to extract the pen before I can begin, and to use it. So the same thing, Genesis is not the start of your Bible. Exodus is the start of your Bible. Because it's Moses that we have to learn. It's through Moses that we're going to learn about a pattern and a beginning of the story, and the Bible also, you see. There are many stories in the book, story of Adam and Eve and flood and Abraham, right? But it's only one story. The scriptures we read are about him, not all the other patriarchs and all the value you see. This is what makes the Bible simple. We think we got to learn all the various stories. No, we know them. But we're seeing it according to a principle. And it's a principle that we're looking at, not the manifestations, mm-hmm. not having to know every jot and tittle. We have him to know principles. He went through beautifully that principally that you have blood, water, and spirit. You can't deny that. Everybody has to have these three parts. You follow? And so when we see these principles throughout these stories, we see the spirit. What I have you holding?
Exodus 6 and 2.
I already talked about it, but go ahead.
Exodus 6 and 2. Mm-hmm. Holy Name Version. And Elohim spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am Yahweh, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob as El Shaddai. But by my name, Yahweh, was I not known to them?
Switch right there. Hold it and switch it over to the King James so I can show it. Same thing.
And God spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty. But by my name Jehovah was I not known to them.
You heard of Jehovah before, huh? Certainly. But see, I said there's no J in the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin. You got Jehovah here. It can't be. You follow? And so what we understand, we have these consonants. What is it? What are they? J? J-H-O-V. J-H-O-V-H.
J-H-V-H.
J-H-V-H, yeah, the O is placeholder, right? J-H-V-H. You see, they took it from the tetragrammaton.
That's right.
Y-H-W-H. Similarities. See, they transliterated and it changed the name to Jehovah because they erroneously substituted for Adonai. And when they had changed the name of Yahweh originally to Adonai, you see, it was Adonai before it became Jehovah. You know what I'm saying? And through Adonai, where's the Adonai? A?
D-R-N-I,
right?
A-I.
AI, and then I. In AI, right?
That's right.
See, it went from Yahweh, that's what they saw. But we read in Exodus, the 20th chapter, that he said, don't take his name in vain, meaning for naught. And so the children of Israel, when they took the name for vain, they died. That's why people don't like the name. They didn't want to say the name because when they pronounced or took the name in vain, things happened. Bad things happen. People die. That's what we read about in the scriptures, the law and the prophets. That's why people don't want to accept the fact that they changed the name to Adonai, which means Lord. And this, you can look this up on any phone or any dictionary, right, for yourself. As we said, we don't want you just to believe it because I'm saying it. Go look it up. And when you see how Adonai changed the Lord, and then they took the vows from out of Adonai, and they made, what was it again? J what? Jehovah.
J-H-V-H.
You see? Then they switched it and made the name Jehovah. And so therefore, they haven't originally went back. They know about the name of Yahweh, but they dogmatically and in error how they extracted Jehovah from Yahweh. And therefore, you have a whole congregation of Jehovah Witnesses as though they're going to witness for Jehovah. They're not talking about Yahweh, even though in their pamphlets, the Watchtower and whatnot, they have the name of Yahweh. But they don't accept the fact that this was the original name given to Moses at the burning bush. And therefore, we stick with it, and we teach by this name. You follow? What do I have you holding right now? Oh, I wanted to go into, grab me Exodus 24 and start about, okay, so you have the name given to Moses at this bush. He comes down into Egypt, you follow? Brings his name down into Egypt and tells Pharaoh to let his people go. Pharaoh doesn't let the people go, you follow? They have this Passover there in Exodus, the 12th chapter, talking about take out a lamb, hold it over to the 14th, you follow? And they're going to kill this lamb. And they have to put blood on the four points of this door and dip it from the basin. Why am I saying this? Because there's two parts. You have the law and the prophets, and you have a fulfillment. And that's what the New Testament portion of the Bible is about. It's fulfilling. Grab me John 17 and 5 and 17. This is the purpose of their beloved Jesus. He didn't come to institute anything. Institute means to start or a way of living. What we're seeing is that Yahshua came to fulfill. And you know what fulfill means? Means to complete.
Come on, Matthew 5:17.
Yeah. Yeah. It means to complete. It doesn't mean to institute. When you have a car payment and you pay your last payment, you don't want them calling and say, hey, Anna Marie, you got another payment. No, I got the pink slip. I've completed my obligation to pay off for the car. There's no more, you're not no more obligated. It's been finished. Read it.
Matthew 5:17, mm-hmm. King James Version. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
So this is their Yahshua. He's telling a group of people, don't think that I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
He's come to fulfill.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Now grab me Matthew 3 and around 18 when John's baptizing them. So that's got you see, there's a completion there. It come to fulfill.
3:13.
Yeah.
Matthew 3:13.
Now he's talking to one man now, John. This is him depicted here on this chart. You follow? On this chart, this is John baptizing Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?
So John saying, hey, you need to be if you don't have no sin, then I need to be baptized of you, Yahshua. Read. But Yahshua says this. Read.
And Yahshua answered and said unto him, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Fulfill. Right? This is the new, so-called New Testament. This is the Old Testament. It's setting up in the law, so everything that's happening in the law and the testament is the institution, it's the starting. And Yahshua, and what he's come to do is to fulfill. And remove the law that was given to the Jews. But for us, we see how he's fulfilling everything. That don't mean we're going to do everything. So when I said the Passover, when Moses gets this name, he comes down into Egypt, and he's told to take out a lamb, you follow? He's taking out a lamb because this was the first thing that they're going to have to do up here. This is what the first thing that happened up here. Right. Because from out of pure spirit, he digressed himself in part, not in totality, in order to create Elohim. That was a death.
That's right.
And what you have Yahshua coming as Yahshua Messiah through the loins of Virgin Mother, through the loins of Virgin Mary. Why? Because he come from out of the loins of Yahweh, right? He said that the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh, and became Elohim. Man, where'd he come from? Come from Virgin Mother Earth,
that's
out
right.
of the dust of the earth.
Right.
You see how that started? There was a coming out of earth. Eve, he said, came out from Adam. So you have that fulfillment of Yahshua, you follow, coming out of the Virgin Mother Mary. You have Yahshua being a lamb. as a lamb that was down here. You had four points of blood down here. You have 4 points of blood on Yahshua, the crown, nailed in his two hands, and the nail in his feet. 4 points of blood fulfills this four points of blood that they had to do here at the last plague, before the last plague came. So this is the fulfillment. So now, after they ate that Passover, they fled from out of here, and they went in through the Red Sea. First Corinthians 10.
Oh, 10.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians 10. He talked about immersions, right?
1 Corinthians 10 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how
no,
that all
we don't want you to be unlearned. Ignorance is unlearned. It's something you don't know. Don't know what? Read.
How that our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
See, that's John writing, or that's Saul writing, about something back here under the law, mm-hmm. under the Old Testament, when they went through the Red Sea. Read it.
And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
See, that's the first time anybody was baptized. This was a baptism. Yahshua, when we just read here that he was going to be baptized in the River Jordan, that was the fulfillment of this. They had to take out a lamb and kill it. They had to take out this lamb and kill it.
Mm-hmm.
You follow? So you were fulfilling these things, which gives us confidence in that Holy Spirit that dwells in us. Mm-hmm. So after they evacuate out of this dark place, court round about, they enter into a holy place. You follow? And they're going to learn and wander here for a particular period of time. But we're going to fast forward real quick so I can show this point of the days of creation, how the world was really created. Some people say 6 days. Some people don't know. The answer is right here in your book. Read it. Exodus 24 and 16. This is the second trip. There's three trips that Moses makes. And we're talking about the second trip. He's told to come up with Yahshua the Messiah, his minister. Not Jesus, but Yahshua the Messiah. I should have got that one, too. I just saw something. But none
you
none
want 13
less.
Or you want 16?
Well, 15, I think, here would be fine.
Okay,
but
15.
He's
going
to come up, and he's going to see something. Read.
Exodus 24 and 15.
Yes.
And Moses went up into the mount, and the cloud covered the mount.
See, this is Moses going up into this mount here, and the clouds covered it. And Moses is, read.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai.
As a cloud. Read.
And the cloud covered it 6 days,
Now the cloud covered it 6 days, What does a colon mean? It refers, in English, means there's a list of things that's supposed to take place, of things happening. You follow? And we got to find out a list of 6 days. What happened in the 6 days? Reread what you just said.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
What happened in those 6 days? Because the next, read it.
And the seventh day.
Now you don't know where the 6 days went.
Right.
You follow? This is why we're reading Exodus now, because you have to have an Exodus before you can have a Genesis. And now it's at this point that we're going to go to Genesis 1 and 1. Read.
Genesis 1 and 1.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Now, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. Read.
And the earth became without form and void.
Elohim created the earth, became without form and void. Read.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
There was darkness. Just like there's darkness down here of ignorance, of not knowing anything, or being in bondage. And now they're going to come through the Red Sea, and they're going to begin to see some light. You follow? Read.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim said, let there be light, and there was light.
Now you're going to have light in this first day. Read.
And Elohim saw the light, that it was good.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night.
Right.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
Now, that was a solar day for Moses that happened. But the creation happened in an instant.
Right.
You follow? Mm-hmm. So there's a vision of Genesis 1:1 talking about what Moses is viewing and discussing and seeing within the confines of his mind. Mm-hmm. And it's at this time that the sequence of the institution or the migration follows suit, and there's a litany of things that is happening from this law of Moses, the testimony of the prophets, and what Yahshua Messiah fulfilled. And when we see how this is working in harmony and what the principles of what the Spirit did down through the ages and the dispensation or his story, you see, we have history is readily rendered his story, and we can see that his story has taken us all the way to where we reside now within this physical age. Age is synonymous to a world. And so you have three ages that reside in the physical. And you got seven ages, though, of time. You got seven ages, three in the realm of time. And it's in this time that we're saying, and everybody's saying that Armageddon is coming or that Jesus is coming back. What they're talking about is the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. And this is what we labor to get the people to understand, because when he revealed himself within our consciousness, we're going to want to know and be like fire or be like him in this physical earth plane. Because after he takes it out and removed, there will be no learning of Yahshua Messiah, because there will be no more earth state to learn in. As the previous speaker beautifully expressed, that you had to take the physical to understand the spiritual. And this is what we're endeavoring to do in this school. So I hope and trust that something was said that might prick your interest to come back and study with us again. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Dr. Love, and that will conclude today's lecture. We have a couple quick announcements. I just got back from Vegas. I was out there for a while. I visited Dr. Bud once while he was in the hospital. He's been released from the hospital. He's home. He's resting. He's still going through the recovery. There's going to be some rehab and stuff that's going to be necessary before he'll be able to get back to his normal state, you know. But I let him know that our thoughts were with him and stuff like that. And he's in good spirits for that matter. Also, while I was out in Vegas, I visited the Las Vegas branch of the school, and they did send their love out to the branch out here. So I just wanted to share that with you all as well. We have no other announcements, do we? Okay. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place where you can learn something about your Heavenly Father. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yahshua, for his wondrous grace, his mercy endureth forever, he's worthy of our faith. No one is deserving to be saved, it's just mercy, Yahshua's mercy. Have me
could have been me. That Yahweh didn't choose, it could have been me. That in the end we lose. It's all in Yahweh's hands, according to his purpose and plan. It's not up to you, whatever you can say or do, it's just mercy. In the end we lose. It's all in